Wi-Fi 7 is officially here. The Wi-Fi Alliance, which is an organization made up of a bunch of different Wi-Fi manufacturing companies, they have announced the new Wi-Fi 7 certification program. So even though Wi-Fi 7 devices have been created over the past year based on the pretty much finished draft of 802.11be, which is what Wi-Fi 7 is, now it's official. They'll be officially certifying these devices. If you go on the Wi-Fi Alliance website, they have a section where you can search for certified products. And right now, they only list a handful, 19 of them, as of like the first day that they announced it. So I'm sure they're going to be rolling out more of these certifications. I'm sure a lot of companies have already applied to have their devices certified soon. So we're definitely going to see many, many hundreds, I'm sure, over the next years. Of course, you're probably all wondering, all right, what's the difference? Who cares? And there are quite a few very interesting improvements to Wi-Fi 7. Now, I made a video about 2 years ago talking in much more detail about like the technical aspects of some of these features. So I'm not going to go over all that detail. I'll put a link here, but I will go over the basics so you can get a good idea about why this is kind of a big improvement. Probably the most notable improvement is the use of the 6 gigahertz spectrum. So you may know that Wi-Fi 6E has the 6 gigahertz spectrum, but that was like an add-on to Wi-Fi 6. Not many devices support it, but Wi-Fi 7 will have it built in. Depending on what country you're in, you're going to get either about 500 megahertz of new bandwidth for channels, or in other countries like the US, 1200 megahertz of new bandwidth. And that's going to add a lot of new options in terms of features, such as a much wider channel. So now they go up to 320 megahertz wide per channel. It's like a combination of a whole bunch of channels of the old days, basically. And that just means, first of all, you can get a lot faster speed potentially. But also that means if you're using a smaller channel, you can fit a lot more routers and devices and get less congestion and competition. So if you're in like an apartment complex that has many, many people living in close proximity, that routers, I assume, will kind of auto negotiate and decide what size channels to use, and you'll be able to fit a lot more in one place, as opposed to like the 2.4 gigahertz spectrum, which has like 320 megahertz wide channels. Now you have even over a gigahertz of space. Another very cool new feature is called multi-link operation. So you probably know, okay, we're gonna have three different bands now. So we're gonna have the 2.4, the 5 gigahertz, and the 6 gigahertz all at once. And here's the cool thing, devices on Wi-Fi 7 should be able to support all three simultaneously. So you don't just have to connect to one or the other. And this means you can do stuff like either increasing the throughput or the bandwidth by broadcasting a bunch of different data across the three channels, or you could increase reliability by broadcasting the same data across all three channels. So if a device is getting a lot of congestion on one band, it might get through on another band and you'll have a lot more reliability. So you'll have to worry a lot less about bad signal. So it'll basically be up to triple redundancy of wireless connection. As for some more technical features, one of them is called 512 compression block ACK. And this basically just means that the router or devices can acknowledge the receipt of many more packets at once. So instead of having to broadcast a new signal saying, yep, I got that packet and I got that packet, for example, it can do a lot more all at once than before. So it's just more efficient. Also, Wi-Fi 7 will be allowed to better control the distribution of so-called resource units. So these are kind of like sub channels. You can think of it like within any given like actual channel of the Wi-Fi. You might divide that up further so each device gets a little sliver of it. And before, potentially you would only be able to assign each device to get one little sliver, but now you could assign multiple so you can basically use all the bandwidth efficiently. And if one device seems to be hogging more bandwidth, just give them more slots. There's also something called triggered uplink access. And this basically allows the router and device to schedule when it's gonna send a packet of information. And this is gonna be useful in time latency sensitive applications, like maybe a video call or gaming and stuff like that, or just general quality of service rules that you might set in your router. And from my understanding, a simple way to think of this is instead of a device trying to send out a bunch of packets and hoping that the router gets it without it being overridden by some other data packet, the router can kind of set aside a time slot and say, okay, you send this data packet now, and I'll make sure that I take it from you at this time and ignore anything else at this particular time. So it just makes sure that certain connections are going to be more reliable. And another very technical improvement is called 4K QAM, which stands for Quadrature Amplitude Modulation. This one's definitely above my head, but from my understanding, it basically has to do with how data is encoded within the radio signal itself. And apparently it just allows more data to be fit within the signal, and they say 20% more transmission rate. So in general, it'll be able to transmit more data. The final big notable feature they highlight is priority access to emergency services. This one is probably just relevant for public Wi-Fi hotspots, or maybe in cases where cell tower companies use Wi-Fi to offload some of the 5G or other cellular signal. But basically, just how cell towers in the US and a lot of other countries have a thing where they will prioritize emergency service devices that I guess are registered, they'll now be able to do that for Wi-Fi connections in addition to cellular. And I don't know how these work exactly. I assume that the government kind of registers this device as being for paramedics or used by paramedics, or this other one is registered as being for police. And then if the cell network detects that there's a lot of congestion, but this particular device is trying to connect in, it'll give this one priority, and the same idea will be able to be applied for Wi-Fi signals. So when will we actually be getting more Wi-Fi 7 devices? Well, now that it's official and certifiable, I'm sure that there's going to be a lot more devices rolling out over this year. I believe the latest high-end phones are going to be using it for sure. I've seen that the Galaxy S24 Ultra will support it based on FCC's certification. Like, that's a separate thing, and they use Wi-Fi 7 according to that. And people are saying the iPhone 16 Pro is likely going to have it. So high-end stuff, and probably laptops, you'll see them start to roll out. I mean, Intel already did create that chip that should be easy enough to drop in if a computer manufacturer wants to spend the extra money to have that higher end feature. And actually, if you go online like Amazon or whatever and search for Wi-Fi 7 devices, you will see a lot of them. Most of them seem to be PCIe Express form factor. And actually, pretty much all the ones I've seen appear to be from Intel's BE200 Wi-Fi 7 chip, which is actually on the new certified devices list. And interesting note, a lot of these chips you see have this like M.2 form factor, and that's what a lot of laptops use. So if your laptop allows opening it up and it has one of these chips to use for the Wi-Fi, then you could theoretically just buy one of these new ones, drop it in. Although I'm not sure how the compatibility would be in terms of like the hardware with the antennas, but thought I'd note it. Now, one final thing I kind of wanted to clarify and go over is how big exactly this 6 gigahertz spectrum is depending on the country, because the US, like I said, is going to be 1200 megahertz along with some other countries, but it seems like Europe, according to this map, is only going to be using about 500 megahertz. And I looked all of this up. Basically, apparently in Europe, there was a conference, the WRC 2023, where a lot of governments and regulators get together and kind of decide on stuff relating to communications. And basically they decided here that for the most part, the upper half of the 6 gigahertz band is actually going to be mainly designated as for mobile use, so for 5G, and then the lower band will be for Wi-Fi. However, they did specify that Wi-Fi is a valid use of the upper half of the 6 gigahertz band. So potentially in some countries, it seems like it's going to be up to the country individually whether or not they regulate and allow Wi-Fi to be used on the upper band. So potentially you'll be seeing some hybrid use of that band. I know in the UK, I believe at least one internet service provider has been talking about that. But basically my point is pretty much everywhere is going to get at least an extra 500 megahertz to use in the 6 gigahertz band. And depending on your country, you might also be getting an additional 700 megahertz as the upper part of that band. So you'll just have to kind of wait and see what your country does. So hopefully you found this video interesting. I am very curious to know how excited you guys are. Are you going to go and get a Wi-Fi 7 router as soon as you can, or kind of wait for more devices to actually use it. That's probably what I'm gonna do, and probably is what makes the most sense to most people. So anyway, if you did enjoy the video, give it a big giant thumbs up for the YouTube algorithm. If you wanna keep watching, I'll put a link to my previous video I made a couple years ago talking about Wi-Fi 7. That information is still relevant. I went into more technical detail about a lot of stuff, so I'll put that link right there if you wanna watch that. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.